started with the next session. So I'm Diane Kelly, I'm from the School of Information Sciences, and I'm really excited today to be introducing to you Jen Golbick. She's an associate professor at the Information School at the University of Maryland. She earned her master's and undergraduate degrees in computer science at the University of Chicago, and she earned her PhD in computer science at the University of Maryland. And she's been, we were just talking about how she was at Maryland as a PhD student and then moved over to the School of Information. And as many of you know, information schools often have lots of great mixes of people and young people with computer science expertise. She's had a really amazing career so far. I'm sure she's got lots of other great things coming up on the horizon. She actually was published one of the first, if not the first paper that did an analysis of tweets made by members of Congress. This was published in 2010, and wow. My memory of this was in part that there weren't a lot of Congress people tweeting.
No, we read all the tweets that had ever been tweeted.
Yeah.
There were like 3,000.
It was a census, yeah. Probably couldn't do that these days. So that's pretty amazing, I think. And she's also published two books that are focused on investigating social media. And what I really have been impressed by, I looked at some chapters in both of the books, is that the books are written for people who maybe don't have a background in computer science or a technical background to be able to understand the possibilities and also get started doing analysis of different types of social media. So that's really exciting. What she's going to tell us about today is sort of a different view of social media, which is thinking about what's going on behind the scenes as we tweet, as we engage with Facebook, as we send queries to search systems. So when we're doing all of these interactions, there's a whole bunch of stuff that's happening outside of our awareness, lots of data about us being collected, put together, and then spun around to do other things for us, maybe some positive and some negative. But in her talk, she's going to give us a little bit of insight into all of those processes and hopefully stimulate you to think about what you're doing and stimulate lots of great questions from you at the end. So, Jen?
Thank you. Yeah, so we're actually working on a paper now on Trump's tweets, which I've now read all of. There's previews on my blog at Psychology Today, but that, you know, I'm hoping takes over the, I'm going to be the leader of Trump Twitter analysis, which will be interesting. So yeah, my goal today is to thoroughly creep you out and hopefully give you some stuff to think about. As I said, I'm a computer scientist, and I basically build algorithms that take all of your data and use it to find out stuff that you never intended me to know. So we started this in my lab probably now like 5 years ago. No one had really done this kind of thing. And we were interested if we could take people's Facebook profiles and predict their personality traits. So how many of you have done a personality test like the Myers-Briggs, that's the INTJ one? How many introverts in the room? The introverts always go like this. I'm one though, so you, the introverts in the room are my people. Yeah, so Myers-Briggs, that's actually a copyrighted test, so there's two well-known ones. The other one is called the Big Five, which is what we used. So it measures introversion and extroversion, agreeableness, conscientiousness, which actually is like, if you are a list maker, you would have a high conscientiousness score. If you're a procrastinator, it would be low. Openness to new experiences, and neuroticism, which is my favorite. So if you're anxious or quick to anger, you would have a high score in neuroticism. So we had hundreds of people take this personality test, and then we grabbed the data from their Facebook profile, but we only took the public stuff, and it was super quantified. So like you could list your favorite books, but we just counted how many characters did they type in that box. Because, you know, if I listed a book, like there's a really low probability that somebody else listed it, let alone a lot of people, right? So we just had, you know, how many characters did you type there? You can list your religion. And so we just looked at people share a religion or not. We didn't look at actually what it was. So it was this very quantified, abstracted way of looking at their data. And basically we dumped that into a machine learning algorithm and it spit out an answer. And the answer that it predicted, you know, what score you would get for each of those traits, was within about 10% of what you actually would get if you took the test. That's how much your score is going to vary depending on like what mood you're in when you take the test. We reran that data like 10 times because I didn't believe that it could work that well. And that kind of started this field of what we sometimes call personal attribute analytics or personal attribute inference. where we try to guess all kinds of things about people by analyzing what they do online. We did a follow-up study where we found we could very accurately predict if people were liberal or conservative and how far in each spectrum. And a lot of colleagues have done work in this space. My favorite study is actually one that comes from Cambridge. All these people are scattered around now, but they were at Cambridge when they did it. And they wanted to predict a whole bunch of different attributes, but just by looking at people's likes on Facebook. So the only thing they considered was the likes, which is interesting, because on one hand, it's this like really anemic slice of all the data that you have on Facebook. On the other hand, it's all public. Like, regardless of your privacy settings, you can't make your likes private. So it's stuff that we know we can get about people. So that was the question. They had like 65,000 people in this study. And they looked at all kinds of things, demographics like race, religion, gender, sexual orientation, behavioral things like if you're a drinker or a smoker or a drug user. They could predict if your parents divorced before you were 21, which I still think is kind of amazing that they got any signal on that at all. But all of this comes from looking at your likes and then kind of connecting those likes to whatever attribute it is they're predicting. And I sometimes get pushback on this being impressive, because like if I like the Jim Beam page on Facebook, there's a really good chance I'm a drinker, right? Like, you don't need a fancy algorithm to go from that like to the fact that I drink. But it turns out that it's very rare that those obvious signals are the things that the algorithms rely on. So in this paper, one thing that they did was predict intelligence scores. So they had people take like a standard IQ test, and they wanted to predict from your likes what score you would get on that test. And they could do that pretty accurately. And they listed in the paper, normally we don't care about this, the four likes that were most indicative of high intelligence and the one that was most indicative of low intelligence. Computer scientists don't care about the why, like we ignore that, but they went and figured it out just to say. So I'm going to tell you the four likes that are most indicative of high intelligence. You can tell me if they're obvious connections. All right, so in no particular order, liking the page for science, which maybe makes sense, like smart people like science, thunderstorms, the Colbert Report, which was great. They actually covered this paper, I think the only computer science they ever covered on that show, and curly fries. So liking the page for curly fries was one of the top four predictors of high intelligence. I like to show it like that. How many of you have kids? This is where I remind you I'm telling you about other people's research and not my own. The number one predictor of low intelligence was liking a page called I Love Being a Mom. Yeah, I know, right? I don't have any kids of my own, but I don't expect enjoying parenthood means you're stupid, right? And curly fries are delicious, but they're enjoyed by people across the intelligence spectrum, so why do we get these weird connections? And the answer is that these likes are basically stand-ins for much more complicated social dynamics that are going on under the scenes. And we don't know why, but I can tell you a story that may or may not be true, but it kind of explains what we're seeing, right? So imagine a smart guy comes along and he's a big fan of curly fries and he decides to make a page on Facebook for people to like. The fact that he's smart has nothing to do with the fact that he likes curly fries, but he makes the page. And so he makes it, he likes it, his friends see it, some of their, you know, they like it, some of their friends see it, and so on. It starts spreading the way things do. So there's two things that we know about this. One is that likes on Facebook, but also things like rumors, fads, viral videos, those spread in social networks the same way that diseases spread offline. We actually take models from the CDC that look at the spread of HIV or the flu, and we put them on top of Facebook, and we can exactly model how stuff like this spreads, which is pretty fascinating. Second, there's a concept from sociology called homophily, which is really important in all of this research. Homophily is a great fancy term, basically for this birds of a feather concept, that your friends tend to be like you. So if you're rich, you tend to have rich friends, and if you're white, you tend to have white friends, and if you dropped out of high school, your friends tended to drop out of high school. And it's not that all of your friends are like that, but that your attributes are more common in your social circle than they are in the general population. Right? So sociologists have known about this for a long time. We know that smart people tend to be friends with other smart people. So this smart guy makes a page. He likes it. His friends see it. Some of them like it. But he's going to tend to have smart friends, right? He's smart, so his friends will tend to be smart. And so some of them like the page, and then their friends see it and like it, but they're going to tend to be smart too. And so what you get is curly fries spreading like a virus through a smart layer of Facebook. So in the end, when you come along and like it, the algorithm doesn't know what curly fries are, and it doesn't know what intelligence is. It just knows you did a thing that high-scoring people did, so you probably are a high-scoring person, too. And that's how we get this. So curly fries has nothing to do with it. There's a really complex social dynamic that we see in all kinds of things, right? And you can see this offline, too. Like, why do certain diseases spread among kindergartners, right? They're all, like, touching each other and touching their faces, right? It's not that it's more contagious for kindergartners. It's that, like, they share a behavior, and they're in physical contact, and it spreads that way. And so here, you know, it's virtual, but it's a social dynamic of people being in contact and the kinds of people they're in contact with that happens to mean that's what happens when you come to this page. It certainly doesn't mean that now. It probably means you watch my TED talk. Ted retitled it The Curly Fry Conundrum, and it has like 2 million views, and people watch it, and then they go like, I'm going to go like the curly fries page, because that will make me smart, which is not how this works at all. But it's an interesting kind of side dynamic. So yeah, I mean, what you can take from this, the really important lesson from this, is that whatever you do to keep a nice, clean social media profile, you can't hide from these algorithms. Because there's no way you could know that liking the page for curly fries says something about your intelligence. And all these inferences work that way. They're not logical connections. They're statistical connections that reflect a much more complex dynamics that we can't really observe. And so if you want to hide something, so say you want to hide your political affiliation, either because you're a conservative in a liberal bastion or the reverse, you might not, right, you could say, I'm not going to do anything remotely political, I'm not going to like anything political, I'm going to keep everything to myself, but the fact that, you know, you like the page for cheeseburgers could indicate that you're a conservative and you're revealed, and you can't hide from that, right? And that's an important thing as we think about the implications of these kinds of algorithms, because they can work on you, and you can't stop them from working on you regardless of what you do. How many people know the story I'm going to tell from my awesome graphic I made here? A couple of you, yeah. So this story comes from the New York Times a few years ago now. It opens with this like almost too good to be true anecdote of this dad in Minnesota who calls up his local Target, and he gets the manager on the phone, and the dad is like in a rage. You sent my 15-year-old daughter this flyer with coupons for baby diapers and bottles and cribs. She's a junior in high school. Do you want her to get pregnant? Going on and on. The manager has no idea what he's talking about. Flyers like that are sent from Target headquarters, not from the stores. Manager tries to calm him down, and in like a great customer service move, 2 weeks later, the manager calls the dad back just to make sure everything's okay. And the dad says, you know, I owe you an apology. It turns out my 15-year-old is pregnant, but Target figured it out before she told us. So how does that happen? How does Target find out? So they don't use social media. What they do have is all of your purchases that you've ever made. Right? If you scan a Target card, or even if you use the same credit cards, they can put that together and they can see these patterns. And of course they want to know the patterns of what you're buying. So it's like, hey, you buy Advil like once every 3 months, and it's been 2.5 months, they give you a coupon for Advil, right? They also want to catch you at times where you might change your shopping habits. So I like basically never shop at Target, right? There's not one by my house. You know, I can walk to Whole Foods, I buy everything else online, that's it, right? I almost never go to Target. When do people change their shopping habits? Very rarely. When they move, which is why, you know, if you've ever bought a house, all you get are coupons for like the first month, right? And when you have a baby. A lot of you said you have kids, so you know the day your first kid was born, you suddenly started buying completely different things than you had ever bought before, right? So it's really easy in a person's purchase history to see when they had a kid. And so if you want to win them over, right, get them to start coming to Target when they have that baby, it's a chance to win over customers that's going to buy all kinds of other stuff there. So Target says, well, let's find out when women are pregnant and start trying to get them in then. So how do you do that? Well, it's really easy to see when women had a kid. So let's just go back like 7 or 8 months and look at what they were buying then, and then we know that they're early in their pregnancy, right? So what's the purchase that reveals a woman's early in her pregnancy? So that's the Family Feud answer, right? You would win if we were on Family Feud. That's the most popular answer. Turns out to be wrong. You know, I mentioned I don't have any kids, but I've bought a couple pregnancy tests, right? You sometimes buy those and hope they're negative. Mine were. Good. Yeah, so it turns out not to be any individual thing, but a combination of things. So they interviewed a guy at Target, and he said, you know, one of the things that's really indicative of a woman early in her pregnancy is that she buys an extra bottle of vitamins and a handbag that's big enough to double as a diaper bag. So not an actual diaper bag, just a big purse. And brightly colored rugs, that combination of things. Right, so you imagine, like, you're in line and the lady in front of you has a purse and vitamins and a blue rug, and you go, totally pregnant. Yeah, you might not have, but now you will, right? You're going to be looking at that lady in front. Why is this? I mean, the vitamins kind of make sense, and you could maybe you can explain the purse thing. I have never heard a really legit explanation for the rug that I believe, right? Because you're not like decorating a nursery when you're 7 weeks pregnant, right? I don't know. Maybe. I don't know. And they don't know either, right? But what they do know is that not only can they compute this score quite accurately for every woman who shops at Target, they can predict her due date by analyzing her purchases. And so they send these flyers out, and it turned out people get really creeped out when they're like, you know, 2 months pregnant and start getting those. So they did some market research. So now they just randomly put in other products. Like there's a lawnmower and a bookcase and a mixer. So you don't know that it's because you're pregnant, except, hey, there happens to be all this really useful stuff that you could use now that you're pregnant, which is a little bit creepy, right? So, yeah, Target does this because knowing if you're pregnant and when you're due allows them to market things to you better. But it shows, again, that you can't really hide from these algorithms because you couldn't know that these statistical connections would mean that vitamins in a purse and a rug are going to show that you're pregnant, right? A pregnancy test, you go, yeah, well, that logically makes sense. But these algorithms don't work on logical connections. They work on these statistical connections. Who knows why? They don't generally give us these explanations, but it allows us to find out an awful lot about people. So the stuff that we've been talking about so far, this is predicting things that are true about you now, right? Are you pregnant? Are you smart? What's your religion? Whatever. What we're starting to do now in this phase is get much better at predicting things that will be true about you in the future. So a few of my favorite examples. One comes from Cornell, and they weren't even trying to predict people's future. They wanted to look at your list of Facebook friends and pick out which one of them was your spouse or your significant other. And all they used was, here's a list of your Facebook friends, and they didn't even use their names or anything. They just numbered them, say, 1 through 400. And then for each one, they knew which of your other friends they were friends with. So like, friend number one is also friends with your friend number 27, 53, whatever. And they've got that. That's it. That's the only data they looked at. So you call that your egocentric social network, your friends and which of them are friends with each other. It's hard for me to get people to guess at this, but if you had to guess, that's all you had. Here's a list of your friends, and for each one, a list of your other friends they know. Which person do you pick as the spouse?
The one who has mutual friends.
Yes, that's a great answer. That works really well. The person you have the most mutual friends in common with. That is, I mean, a really effective way of doing it. So these researchers knew about that. They wanted to take it one step further on top of that. And so what they did is come up with this great concept they call social dispersion, which I think is a wonderful name, for a pretty simple idea. You know, if you think about your social circles, online or offline, they tend to fall into some pretty distinct groups, and I definitely have this. So, like I play ice hockey on a men's team, so I've got this group of like, you know, 40 guys I play hockey with, and they're all friends with each other on Facebook, and they don't know anybody else in the rest of my life, which is fine, right? So I've kind of got that circle. I grew up in this little tiny town in northern Illinois, and so I have like my high school friends. I come from this big Catholic family, 30 cousins on Facebook, right, that are all connected. There's actually no connections between my high school friends and my group of cousins, except for my brother and sister-in-law, who went to high school with me, and then obviously they know all the cousins. And then I went away to college, so I've got college friends, and then I've got kind of grad school professional friends that merged together. And this group of like random women I met on an internet message board, and we're all Facebook friends, right? But all these groups are really separate. There's almost no connections between them. So 2 years ago I got married. My husband and I have like no common background. He is German, we didn't go to school together, we don't work together, he's not an academic, and so he knows very few of my friends, actually. So he plays on my hockey team, right? But if I were like, you know all the guys on the hockey team, so I don't need to introduce you to anybody else that I know, that would be bad, right? Like, that's not a sign of a healthy relationship, that you're like, you know 30 people, so that's it. Like, quota met, right? And if you look, he's actually connected to every one of those social circles. He met like one of the internet girls when she came into town and like we went out to dinner, right? He's met a few of my crazy cousins at a wedding. He, you know, knows a couple high school friends who came through town. And so he's connected to all those groups. And what social dispersion measures is how many of those groups is a person connected to, or what percentage. And so it's a little more complicated than that. But basically, we're going to pick the person who's connected to the most number of groups. And it includes a little bit like also how many mutual friends do you have. So this works really well. This is right about 75% of the time, which is really impressive. Like, you're picking from a list of like 400 people, right? And 75% of the time, you get the right one. They wanted to know, maybe we could refine this a little bit and make it even more accurate. So 2 months later, they went back, they recollected all this data. And what they found out is that if they had guessed wrong for you in the first place, that you were 50% more likely to have broken up in those 2 months than if they guessed right. So essentially, they can tell you if your relationship is going to last, like while you're in it and you think everything is going fine. And actually, they can tell you who's the better person, right? Like, doesn't look like stuff's going to work out with Bob, but Frank looks like he's going to be a great choice, right? And they had no idea that this is what they were going to end up with, but it turns out that, like, that kind of structure, which is, you know, it's like just your data, but it says a lot, again, because it's not that this number matters, it's that there's all these other social dynamics that explain why you would end up with these kinds of connections. So that's one, and that kind of started us going like, oh, maybe we can predict, like, what's going to happen about people. My colleague Munmun Dechaudhry, who's now at Georgia Tech, did a wonderful study, also looking at future prediction, and we're coming back to the pregnancy theme. They looked at, what they wanted to do is predict if pregnant women would go on to develop postpartum depression or not. So they followed hundreds of women over the course of their pregnancies on Twitter, and they collected all their tweets and all their behavior, you know, everything they liked and favorited and retweeted. And they built a model, so on the day the woman gives birth, they can predict with about 80% accuracy if she'll develop postpartum depression or not. Like, she's not actually postpartum yet, right? Partum, is that what you are when you actually have a baby? She's partum still. And they can tell. Which, I love this study because, like, wouldn't it be great for any condition if you can, like, go in, right, you're getting ready, you know you're gonna have a kid in about a week, and your doctor, she can push a button that looks at your Twitter feed and knows if you need to be monitored for this condition, especially something like postpartum depression, which often gets overlooked because you're supposed to be happy and glowing because you have a new baby. And even if you're, you know, really suffering, a lot of times you don't want to tell people that. Now your doctor knows that you need to be monitored for it. If they include like the first few days after pregnancy, they can get even more accurate. And it's all kinds of weird little things that end up being indicative, and we don't know the whys for all of them, which is kind of the story of this research, because computer scientists don't really look at whys, they just look at outputs. So, for example, so all these women change the way they use Twitter over the course of their pregnancy, which is not surprising, right? Stuff's going on, you know, you've got other stuff to think about than Twitter. But the women who developed postpartum depression and the women who didn't changed in diverging ways in a lot of cases. So women who developed postpartum depression increased the number of questions that they were asking over the course of their pregnancy, where it decreased for the other group. I think they should be looking at what those questions are, but they didn't. So they could be questions like about pregnancy, but they could be questions about like the latest episode of House of Cards, right? We don't know, we just know that the questions went up. This is like automated text analysis that you can do to see that. A lot of subtle language things come out there too. The use of adverbs increased among the postpartum depression, decreased otherwise. Women who developed postpartum depression increased their use of first-person pronouns and decreased third-person pronouns. So first-person like I, me, and my, third-person like his, hers, and theirs. They went the opposite way for the women who developed postpartum depression. Why does this happen? We don't really know. There's this whole kind of field called psycholinguistics, which is a kind of combination of linguistics and psychology, and now a little bit of computing also, that finds these amazing clues. And actually, most of this research I've talked to you about has this psycholinguistic component that looks at the kinds of words you use, that those tend to be tremendously indicative of your psychological state or even stable things like your personality. So those feed into a lot of this research, but we don't really understand the whys yet. We're getting good at sort of seeing what the differences are, but there's decades of work to come on understanding the So, you know, what about this work? I used to present this going like, it's an unmitigated good, right? All this creepiness I've been telling you about, like this one is not creepy, except then like your boss could run it too, right? And that's a little bit creepy. CVS could run it, right? To know like, hey, they can send you some coupons for medications, or like drug companies could run it, right? Here's all these women who gave birth, like let's grab their Twitter feeds and see if they're depressed and then send them recommendations. Like, that's a little bit creepy, right? And that's a problem with these algorithms too. So we build them to run on open, available data, because as academics, we only have access to open, available data. But that means anybody can get that data. And the algorithms, like we write papers and say, here you go, like here's how you do it, and anybody can do it. You have no rights to prevent any third party from running these algorithms on your data. You would if you were in Europe, but you don't here, which is something I think we're eventually going to have to fix, right? But there's a huge amount of power that lies in this that anybody can use, and they can use it for really good things, like I think this case shows, but also in ways that we really might not want to happen. We just finished a study. Any day we're going to get a decision on this paper. So late-breaking results for all of you. So we were doing a similar thing to this. We were looking at people who announced on Twitter that they were going to their first Alcoholics Anonymous meeting. It takes out the anonymous part. I don't know how that affects our results. But yeah, we have hundreds and hundreds of people did this. So I'm going to my first AA meeting, gonna get stuff back in order. We filtered out all the jokes. There's a very common joke where people take like a bunch of AAA batteries and put them in a circle and call it the first AA meeting. It was like funny the first time, but you'll find this all over Twitter. Some of you get the joke. I see some of you giggling. A lot of people go for class. So if you're in like a counseling program, they'll have you just go and sit in on an AA meeting. So we filtered that out. We found people who were really legitimately going. And then we followed their tweets after that to determine at 90 days if they were sober or drinking again. And we made sure they explicitly said. So you know, if they're talking about being hungover, we know that they're drinking. But we followed them for a while. So they could, say, celebrate 6 months of sobriety, and then we would know at the 90-day mark they were still sober too. Then we took all the tweets from before they went to that first AA meeting and used that to build a model to predict if they would be sober at 90 days or not. 90 days is kind of one of these key early addiction recovery indicator points. We can get it right about 85% of the time from looking at your tweets from before, which is like great and also really sad because most people are back to drinking at that point. Only about 20% of people actually stay sober. Yeah, and we read all these tweets. Yeah, I was joking, we did read all the Congress tweets in that paper. There were like 3,000 of them. We read all the tweets from these, you know, 600 people. A lot of them were like 18 and 19 going to AA. So we had, and we actually have this in my lab, like strategies for dealing with reading really depressing, terrible, awful stuff on Twitter that we had to implement for this. So we were able to build these models, but one thing you probably have caught as I've talked about all this research is that though I am a computer scientist, I find our interest in the output tremendously unsatisfying, right? I mean, computer science, the question is, can you compute this? And how well, fast, whatever, can you compute this? And you're not looking for the insights in the middle, you're looking for can you compute it? So can we compute if people will be sober 90 days later? We can, with pretty good accuracy. We don't know why. And you know, I keep showing you all these examples where it's like, who knows why that's true? That kind of drives me crazy, which is why I'm in an iSchool and not in a computer science department anymore. So what we did in this project is that we went to the addiction literature, right? There's people who study addiction, and we looked at what are the things that they look at, right? So if I'm like, tell me, you know, what would you look at if you want to know if I'm going to stay sober? So they have papers on this, right? They look at things like, are you in a social circle that's drinking all the time, right? Which makes sense. So we go, well, how do we operationalize that on Twitter? So we took all the people that they followed and then followed them back. And we built a dictionary of alcohol-related words built from you know, vocabularies, WordNet, stuff that's out there, you know, refined it down. And then we said, all right, like what percentage of the words that your friends use are related to drinking? And it's a small percentage, right, because people say a lot of stuff, but there's enough variation that this was a meaningful predictor. If you have friends who talk more about booze, then you have a lower chance of recovering. Coping style is another big predictor. So this is a psychological attribute that deals with basically how you respond to stressful situations. Now, there's a handful of different styles, but they essentially break down to positive and negative styles. Positive styles kind of have two groups. One is that if you're faced with a stressful situation, you try to come up with a way to resolve it, right? So like that jerk at work sent me this email and it was totally dismissive. If you're a person like me who lays in bed and drafts response emails in your head, there's actually, I'm glad there's some of you in the room. Some people just look at me blankly. But yeah, that's a positive coping style because you're coming up with a way to address the thing that's stressing you, right? And so finding that way to resolve the stressor is a positive way. There's some things that you can't resolve, right? So a loved one dies. Can't fix that. And so another positive coping style is essentially turning to your social circle for support to get through those stressful times. Negative coping styles, or what we call maladaptive coping styles, are things like emotional distancing, where you just like you start thinking about the thing that's stressing you out. You're like, I'm not even going to think about it, right? I'm just going to put it over there. This is really common among people who have PTSD. Right, and if you have studied that or even you know about it casually, like that's something that happens, right? So soldiers come back from war, they think about these really terrible things that they went through, and then they're like not gonna think about it, right? They distance themselves from it. That doesn't resolve the thing that's stressing them out, and so it becomes a problem in a way. There's also avoidance coping, which is essentially getting drunk or taking drugs or something. Like, oh, I'm so stressed out, so I'm gonna go get drunk. The stressor is still there when you become sober again. So it's just kind of avoiding thinking about it. That's a maladaptive coping style. So we kind of took a diversion and built another model to predict coping style from people's tweets, which comes back to this kind of psycholinguistic analysis I was talking about. We can tell by the words people use if they have analytic thinking styles, which is directly tied to this problem solving. We can tell what kind of social support and social relationships they have from the kinds of words that they use. And so essentially we can say these are the indicators of good coping style, and that allows us to predict this. We published a separate paper on our ability to predict coping style, and we use that on all of our alcoholics to know if they had a good coping style or a bad coping style. We actually did about 20 of these different features, like the two that I've described to you. So in the end, you know, if you come in, we can run you through our algorithm and say if you're going to be sober or not. And if it says no, we can tell you why and what to do about it, right? So we can say, it looks like you have a maladaptive coping style. Cognitive behavioral therapy can help with that. Here's, you know, a thing to go look it up. Here's places near you that you can go get it. Because it's a conscious choice, right? You can make yourself not go get drunk, or you can make yourself think about it. So we can do that. We can say, you know, your friends are all talking about getting drunk all the time, so maybe you want to adjust your social circles. And so it can be good, right? You can think of ways that this isn't just going to predict, but also can lead to some kind of interface that will help. This can also be, I'm terrified by this research that we did, because it can be used in all kinds of ways that I think would be awful. And like the main one that comes to mind for me is that in a lot of states, if you get pulled over for your first DUI, they'll let you go to AA instead of sending you to jail, right? And I was talking to, it's interesting, because I was using this as an example of like, of course, everyone will see why it would be bad if, say, a state legislator or a judge says, run them through the algorithm, and if the algorithm says AA will work, let them go, and if it says it won't work, send them to jail, right? Yeah, you are making the face that I want you to make at that. But I was talking to this very reasonable guy who was like visiting me in my office, and I was telling him this, and he goes, no, like that's a great idea. To send the people to jail if the algorithm says it won't work, because it's good for public safety, right? You're taking someone who's probably going to get drunk again off the road. And it's like, yeah, okay, so now really there are reasonable people who think this is an okay thing to do, and I find that really troubling, right? Because it's very pre-crime, right? Like, you haven't actually done anything wrong yet, but we're going to send you to jail to keep you off the road because you might do a bad thing going forward. It's not quite pre-crime, but it's getting really close. And we're absolutely going to get there. We actually started this alcoholism study because we're looking at predicting DUI recidivism. So if you committed DUI, can we look at your tweets and know if you're going to get another one, say, within the next year? That can be pre-crime, right? If I predict that you will get another DUI, then we can like arrest you ahead of time for that second DUI, right? We haven't finished that study yet, mostly because it's really hard to get that data. But it's coming, and the technology is there to make all this work just fine.
Okay.
So we're thoroughly worried, right? Good. A little bit more worried. So all these algorithms work only if we have access to data about you. And so the question is, how easy is it to get that data? So now I have terrified everyone enough, they're going to go delete their Facebook profiles or whatever, check your privacy settings. And so I want to share this video with you. This is from a website called Take This Lollipop. You can make one of these videos for yourself. So you can Google Take This Lollipop, or you can go to takethislollipop.com. Don't do it now because they're sound. You will embarrass yourself. But it's an interactive movie that pulls from your Facebook page. So you do connect with Facebook, and it will make you this movie. I'm going to show you the one that it made for me. When this came out, now probably 3 or 4 years ago, it was this huge thing. Everybody was talking about it. And I was like, you know, I'm not going to bother because I have like the world's strictest Facebook privacy settings, right? I study this. So I want everything locked down. I have all the boxes checked to keep apps from pulling my data. It's not going to work. I'm not going to do it. And everybody keeps talking about it. And it's like my job to know about these things. So I said, OK, I'm going to run it. I'll see what happens. And this is the video that it made. So I'm just going to play it. And then we'll talk about it. It's about 2 minutes, so it should be pretty quick.
Thank you for sharing.
Yeah. You're welcome. I'll talk through a little bit, since you might not recognize it, since it's my profile. Thank you. There you go. So it says Brian Keeney's next. It picks one of your friends and puts their name under the razor bladey lollipop there. That's terrifying, right?
Yeah.
I mean, terrifying for the content, but also I didn't think this was going to pull any of my data, right? And I'm like literally one of the world's experts on Facebook privacy settings. Like, I do this full time. And I was completely wrong about what it could get. So like, if I don't know, literally no one on earth can know how their data is getting out there. Because this is all I do. And I was wrong. And I went back and I checked, you know, I have the box checked that says apps can't pull my data. Why does this happen? So it turns out that box is there because if your friend installs an app, your friend's app can pull your data by default. Which means if you have friends that like don't know about this stuff, your data is getting out to all of these apps. So that box prevents your friend's apps from pulling your data. But Facebook just assumes if you install an app, you want to override all of your privacy settings and give them everything, right? And this is part of the problem. Like, not only can't we hide from these algorithms because they use non-logical connections, we can't control what data they're getting because a lot of it's getting out there anyway. Facebook apps are less concerning than what your phone is giving away, which is like everything, pretty much. I mean, you can install like a flashlight app that tracks your location 24 hours a day. Sites like Uber or apps like Uber, they pull your chat histories, your contact list, like your archive of phone calls. Like, they can see stuff that you're sending to other people. It's like spyware for your phone, and it just ships it all over to Uber, right? Uber needs to be picked on plenty, but they're not the only ones who do this, right? It's a pretty common practice. And then there's ways that it gets out where we don't know, and sometimes it's unintentional, but if you remember the Pokemon Go issue from this summer, they, you know, a lot of apps, like the app stores, require you to use a third-party login. So they had a Google login for you to use it. And I don't think they wanted to steal people's data. I think some programmer, you know, early on was just like, request full permissions, and we'll fix it later. But it requested full permissions, which meant Pokemon Go could download and read all your emails from Google, which was terrifying. And it was like weeks before anybody figured out that that's what it was doing, right? So millions of people were downloading this app and giving Nintendo, I guess, access to all their Gmail, right? And I, you know, I don't think they took it, and they were kind of mortified, and they fixed it really fast. But like, what other things are you signing into with Facebook or Google that are requesting those permissions that we don't even notice, right? Millions of people didn't notice this, and they have access to everything, right? The data is getting out there, and that's not even talking about the data brokers who are buying up records, buying up your purchase histories, packaging up and selling it, and you have no right to control that, right? So the question is like, now what, right? Now that we're all thoroughly terrified, what do we do? Okay, so thing one is that this is not all bad. We have these algorithms in our life every day in ways that we're very comfortable with. So if you have like Netflix or Amazon, when Netflix recommends shows to you or Amazon recommends stuff for you to buy, underneath it's exactly the same algorithms that we're talking about here. That Curly Fries study uses something called SVD, singular value decomposition, which is a matrix thing. It's exactly what Netflix and Amazon use. And if you think about it, it makes sense, right? It just is, instead of saying you look conservative or you look like someone who's pregnant or you look like someone who's smart, they say you look like someone who would like Ghostbusters, right? Same thing. We're really comfortable with that. And we know, well, most of us are, I'm getting a suspicious look. Most of us are comfortable with that. Yeah, there is actually a big question about how comfortable people are. We did a side note, we did a little study where we asked people, and I was shocked by the results of this. We just published this year. We went on Mechanical Turk and we said, here's a bunch of data points. Would you be upset if these were used to personalize your experience on the web? And I was expecting that there'd be like a couple things that would upset people. But there's stuff that like every day is used in these systems that people found really intrusive and violating. I did my dissertation on predicting trust between people. So I could take someone I don't know in a social network and kind of look at our, you know, my friends and their friends and so on to find a path to that person and then guess how much I would trust them. And we use that to like make movie recommendations. So, you know, this guy Bob gave this movie 5 stars. Can I use that to help figure out how much I'll like it? And we use that trust as a way to kind of weight it. I'm very concerned about privacy. I thought this was fine. And in my study, I put in, have any of you done Mechanical Turk research? So Mechanical Turk is this, it's basically a platform Amazon hosts where people come in and they'll do, sometimes they'll do big surveys like I did. Sometimes they'll do like, is this a picture of a dog? Yes or no? And they get paid like 1 cent to answer that. But sometimes people just randomly click on stuff to get paid faster, so you put in these attention checking questions to make sure they're paying attention. So we put in this attention checking question that said, you know, I'm asking how intrusive would it be to have this thing and this thing and this thing. And so we put in, a company sends a representative to your house and he sits on your couch 24 hours a day and watches you. And that was, you better mark that as intrusive or else we'd throw it out. So he, it was on a 7-point scale. The guy on the couch got like a 6.7 intrusiveness rating. That's good. The trust between you and your friends that's computed got like a 6.5. It actually was higher than the dude on the couch until we threw out some people who didn't give the dude on the couch a high enough creepiness rating. People were horrified at the idea that you would figure out how much they would trust one another and use that. And this is commonly done these days. So yeah, your skeptical look is right. It's done all the time. People don't say a lot about it. But yeah, there's a whole bunch of unease if they actually knew what was going on. Fair enough. But we know how to handle those, at least, right? So most people do not just like watch the movies that Netflix recommends one after the other, right? I've said that, and sometimes I get a skeptical look from people because that's exactly what they do. They just watch the first one, and then they watch the next one, and then they watch the next one. But you certainly don't go to Amazon and just buy each thing that it recommends, right? And we know how those algorithms work, which is just like I've been telling you. Most of the time, they're right, but in non-useful ways. They tell us things that would be completely obvious. So, you know, on Amazon, like, you buy the new Stephen King novel, and it recommends 10 other Stephen King novels. Like, it's true that you would like those, but you don't need the algorithm to tell you. Sometimes they're straight out wrong. Our algorithms are wrong 15 to 20% of the time. And then sometimes they're right in these, like, brilliant, insightful ways. We call this serendipity is our technical term for it. And you see this especially like on streaming music, like if you listen to Pandora and it'll play you this song and it's like you've never heard the song, you don't know the artist, but it's exactly what you like, right? Those moments, we want more of those. My favorite one of those that I got, so I bought the Zombie Survival Guide from Amazon, which is, yeah, it's exactly what it sounds like, Outdoor Survival Guide, but for zombies. It was written by Max Brooks, who wrote World War Z, that Brad Pitt zombie movie from a couple years ago. And so it's hilarious, right? Like, if the zombies come, like, here's what you do for food, and here's what you do for this. And so it came, like, I read it in a day. And I go back to Amazon, and it says, hey, like, based on your purchase of the Zombie Survival Guide, you might like, and it's got the author's other books, and Pride and Prejudice and Zombies, some zombie movies, and then this, like, 18-inch hand axe for camping that has a 12-inch knife that pulls out of the handle. And I was like, that's exactly what I need, right? Yes. This book is like, oh, for close-in zombie combat, you need a short axe. And I was like, all right, I probably don't need this axe. But I bought it anyway. I have it in my attic in my, like, Death of Civilization kit. Which I'm, we need those in D.C. because we're going to be where it starts. I was just refreshing it last week. So the thing is there. So my house is a place to come if there's zombies or other problems. But yeah, I mean, I love that recommendation because, like, I definitely would have not have gone looking for a hand axe, let alone, I mean, this knife is like giant that pulls out of the handle. It's awesome. But enough people bought this zombie survival guidebook and then went and bought the hand axe that the algorithm can surface, like, not just zombie books and movies, but like this weapon, right, which I bought. I love that. So we know how to handle these, right? Mostly not helpful, though correct, sometimes wrong, sometimes brilliant, like amazing suggestions. What we're starting to see now, though, is that these algorithms are being treated more like oracles of truth, right? So we, in the research space, call these decision support systems now, but they're kind of being used as decision correction things, which is interesting, because when I was doing that trust research, I graduated in 2005, so that was quite a while ago. I'd go talk to computer scientists who didn't know what social networks and social media were then, right? There was no Facebook when I was doing this work. And I'd say, look, so we, you know, we calculate how good our trust inference is. So if I say, you know, if we know each other, and I give you a 9 out of 10 trustworthiness, and the algorithm says 6. So I say, okay, well, the error in my algorithm is 3, right? It said a 6, and I say it's a 9. And the computer scientist would go, well, maybe you should just trust her at a 6. Like, if the algorithm says a 6, maybe that's the right answer, right? That's like, oh, you all know nothing about, like, human beings, right? It's a very computer science-y answer. So the computer scientists are winning with what's going on now. This, what I'm showing you here, is a screenshot from one of the first commercial tools that's kind of exposing these algorithms to the public. This is something called Crystal Nose. So it's crystal like a glass and nose with a K. It's a Google Chrome plugin for Gmail. So you can download and get a free trial. And it lets you send what they call empathetic email, which is hilarious because it's empathetic because of what an algorithm tells you. So you can tell it's computer scientists like reinterpreting words to mean different things. And so you start typing an email, you put in an email address, it pulls up a profile like this. This is the one from their website, so I'm not showing you any personal information for someone. And so it gives you this profile. So this guy is persuasive, independent, loves to take calculated risks, sometimes disregards existing structures. And if you scroll down, it says, here's how you write a good email to this person. Be very direct, keep it short, here's some phrases to use. It's already taken care of, it's up to you. You can do better than that. Things not to say, follow these instructions. The most trusted, or rest assured, avoid those phrases. So that's kind of interesting. But as you start typing your email, it will highlight sentences, and if you right-click, it will suggest how you should rephrase that sentence to make it more appealing to the person that you're writing to, right? So we're not talking about decision support. This would be decision support, right? To say, you're going to write an email, this guy likes stuff that's short, here's some stuff that he's not going to be responsive to. But as you start writing, it goes, no, no, no. Like, you screwed that up, human being who knows the other human being you're writing to. Change it to say this, because that's going to be more empathetic, right? Our algorithm knows better. Also, we don't know where they get this data from. They don't say, right? They say public sources. Someone hinted to me that, like, hey, you know, you have to give them access to your email to do this, right? When you install the plugin. They're like, maybe they just download all your email and don't tell you. And I have no evidence that they're doing that, but I was like, oh no, like maybe that's exactly what they're doing. Who knows, right? Yeah, so we don't know where they're getting this, but I like to show this example. I mean, I have no interest in this company. I have no idea how well they're gonna do. Their profile of my professional address looked a lot like this, which is pretty accurate. The one for my personal address, like, could not have been more wrong. So it's a paid service. You know, if people feel like they're gonna make more money doing this, they'll succeed, I don't know. Interestingly, the people who are most excited about this are university development officers. Like, when I go, you know, I give talks like this every week, the university development people get really excited about this. And you could imagine, right, that, like, instead of, are you a development person?
Yes.
No? You want it?
I'm in.
All right. I'm gonna tell you my strategy for university development officers.
Okay.
So you get the forum email, right? So these personality profiles, I think there's 82 different personality types, right? So it's not unique for everyone. You kind of get put in a bucket. So you can imagine, so you take the forum email that you're gonna send, and then you run basically each person on your list through this algorithm to figure out which bucket they fall into, which is gonna take some time, but it's a one-time cost, right? So you have to hire an undergrad to do it. Everybody's then classified in your database. You know, pick one person from each category, paste in your form email, and then rewrite each sentence as it's suggested, and then you have 82 form emails. It's a little more work, but if it gets you like 5% more donations, it's probably worth the time. Depends how many donations you get, I guess.
A lot.
So 5% increase would be a lot more money. You could hire a couple undergrads to do that work that I just suggested, right? And then, like, for each form email, all you do is, you know, a process that probably takes half a day for an undergrad. It's not a high effort thing, right? Paste it in, rephrase, make it sound nice. And then you send out just to, you know, personality group number one gets email number one. Group number two gets email number two. Is this a good thing or a bad thing? I don't know. Part of me goes, if I got more short emails, my life would be better, right? Like, University of Chicago, they just had, like, Giving Week or something. I don't know how many emails I got from them. If I just got, like, a two-sentence email that was like, hey, it's Giving Week, our ranking will go up if you donate something, please click here and give us $20, I would probably do it. If I have to read, like, the this long thing from that random dude I didn't like very much in my class, like, I delete it. I don't read it. I delete it, right? So it could work, and my life would be better. My students know this, right? They know one question per email. Because I'll just answer the first one and send to get it out of my inbox. And so if they send me 5 emails, that's fine, right? So that would help. At the same time, it feels a little manipulative, right? That it's, you know, is not very authentic. Not that a form mail is either. But there's a line here where some people are very uncomfortable with this, right? And I think that's part of the issue going forward, is where do you draw that line? And like I said, I talk about stuff like this every week with all kinds of different groups, right? I was talking with event planners last week, and I think in 2 weeks I'm going to like a nurses conference, right? I talk about this with everybody, and I don't have any answers for them, but I can tell you the right things to think about, right? Which is like, what's the data that's going in? Like, is it my social media data? Is it my emails? Is it my health records, right? What's the thing that you're finding out? Is it that I want to watch House of Cards, or I like short emails, or that I have a very high risk of developing obesity and heart disease, which we can also predict, by the way, right? Lots of health conditions. And who's going to use it, right? So is it CVS who's going to market something to me, or Walgreens? Is it university development people who are going to ask me for money? Is it my boss who's going to decide if I should get that promotion, or if I should be put up for that award, because maybe I politically agree with him and maybe I don't, right? So I think a place to think about the line is how sensitive is the data and how useful is the output to the person whose data you're using. So, you know, I'm willing to give my doctor a whole bunch of personal information if she's going to find out something that will be helpful to me. And I would not give that same data to my boss, right? I'd be very upset if my boss ran those algorithms on me, and I'd be fine with my doctor doing it. I think what a lot of this comes down to, both in the space of algorithms and in the general kind of social media privacy space, is really an issue of consent. I would like it that we would have to get explicit consent to do all of this, and you have to do that in Europe. Like, that's their law, and that's why we see all of these crazy lawsuits like the right to be forgotten on Google, where you can have your search results removed. There was a great German one where the European courts decided that they couldn't put your house on Google Street View without your consent, so you can have it fuzzed out. So if you look at Google Street View in Germany, all these houses are fuzzed out because they're like very sensitive to that kind of privacy that we aren't as much here because corporations own our data here and we're used to that kind of culture, right? But so I think that's it. The consent is ultimately the issue. You can't explicitly ask for it here. I mean, you could, but you don't have to, and it's a lot of work to do. We don't have any automated mechanisms. And so I think there's a place for thinking really hard about, if this is being used, would people consent? Or what kinds of people would and what kinds of people wouldn't, based on what you're giving them, what you're putting in, and so on. But I also think in this, I don't talk about with the corporate people, but I can talk about with you, that we need a heck of a lot better set of laws to deal with this kind of thing. Which was like a great thing to say up until 6 months ago, and now we all have a lot of other things that we're kind of worried about, and I'm pretty sure that this is not going to make the top of the legislative agenda. That said, so I'm based in Maryland, but I don't really know the geography, so this is DC on my necklace, and Maryland is the top point, and Virginia is the part that's cut off, right? Like, there's like 6 miles separating all of us, so we all travel all around. So I've been talking to Mark Warner, who's the senator from Virginia. He's super interested in this privacy stuff. So is Al Franken. He's way into this kind of privacy stuff. And they're talking about all kinds of interesting legislation that can force some of this on people. So Mark Warner's office, I was just talking to them last week, and he's on the Commerce Committee. And they're talking about requiring companies to, in their kind of reports, right? So public companies have to put out these quarterly reports, to include an assessment of the value of all the user data they have and the liability that would go with it. So if their data were breached, like how much would it cost? So they have to publicly report this, which would be really interesting because we don't know at all what our data is worth now, right? That's what we were talking about, like how would they measure this?
Yeah.
Like, we don't know. They're gonna figure it out, maybe, and maybe pass a law about it, which is an interesting kind of roundabout way to get us towards maybe some more rights about this. But I think it's a really important thing to manage because the real lesson I want you to come away with is that there's a huge amount of power in these algorithms. The ability to absolutely ruin people's lives overnight, fairly and unfairly, right? You could certainly imagine this. We're really good at inferring religion, right? So let's just run it on everybody coming in through immigration, right? We're like halfway there in the last few weeks anyway. So let's just run it, right? And then it's not a religious test, it's just an algorithm test, and we'll call the output something else, right? There's a huge amount of power in these algorithms, and we have basically no rights to control how they're being used or what's being done with them. If you want to get really upset about this, there's a great book that came out over the summer called Weapons of Math Destruction by Kathy O'Neill. She was a hedge fund person. She has a PhD in math, worked at hedge funds, quit to go work with Occupy Wall Street because she's like, I like what they're doing. They don't know anything about finance. And she wrote this book, which I didn't want to like because I don't like manifestos, which this is. But she's a mathematician, so they write different kinds of manifestos. And it basically said, look, these algorithms, like, they're used all over the place, but they can be used in ways that are systematically unfair, opaque, and we have no right to respond to. And she gave this great example in the DC public schools. They use these algorithms to rank teachers. We don't know what the input is. They just get output in a ranking, and then they fire the bottom 250, right? So they fired this teacher who everybody loved. Like, she seemed to have a productive classroom, her students were learning, principals loved her, parents loved her, students loved her. She's like, I have no idea how I got on this list. How did I end up at the bottom? They won't say, right? Most of the people in the school district don't even know, right? We don't know what goes in there, it just spits this out. They would not reinstate her. And so she was fired for like 3 days, and then one of these very rich suburban counties in Virginia, which are adjacent to DC, they're the richest counties in the country, hired her to work in their public schools, right? This is exactly what we don't want to happen. I mean, it's great that she got a job, but we don't want inner city schools that are deprived of resources and good teachers losing good teachers to rich suburban schools because of algorithms that are clearly spitting out the wrong answer in some cases, and we have no rights to challenge them. That's the space that we're in now. It's going to be happening more and more. And so I think, like, just with, you know, all of this kind of policy, corporate stuff aside, citizen-wise is a thing we need to keep an eye on, because it is a tremendous amount of power in the hands of corporations and governments that we have little control over now. And we want to be able to push for that control when it's time for us to have it. So on that happy note, I'm done talking, but I think we have a little bit of time still for questions.
Thank you.
So who is, can actually make a question now, and is that a little shot?
Okay, so legislation can protect us, but that's probably going to be a long time coming.
I agree.
What else can we do to protect ourselves?
So I think the really practical advice that I have is that these algorithms only work on the data that you have available. So there's some stuff you can't do anything about. Data brokers, for example, like, you can't see what's in there, you can't tell them to delete it. But you can do a lot with the social media stuff that is available. So a couple years ago I deleted everything I had done on Facebook. I didn't delete my account. I just deleted all my posts and all my likes and all my comments. It took me 2 weeks, 8 hours a day, full time, to do that. I wrote an article about it, so I at least counted as work. Now there are automated tools to help you do that. You kind of have to let them run overnight. But I had like 30,000 things to delete on Facebook. But now I run it every 2 weeks. So there's a thing called Facebook Timeline Cleaner, which is a browser plugin. It takes forever to run if you have a lot of stuff. But so I only have like 2 weeks worth of content on Facebook at a time. Because I've kind of decided, like, some people like to use it as an archive for their life, and I've said, I don't trust Facebook. Like, Facebook is kind of my enemy, which is, we can have that conversation over drinks about why, but I don't get along with them. I don't want them to be the ones that store my data. They're making money off me. So, like, how about I store my data someplace else? You can download an archive of everything you have on Facebook, all your posts and photos and whatever, so you can personally keep it. And so I only have a couple weeks worth of stuff on Facebook. None of these algorithms work on me. If you want to try them yourself, you can. So if you just do a Google search for me, and like, so I have a blog on Psychology Today, which is not huge. You'll find there's a post in there called like, Find Out What Algorithms Know About You. And it links to being able to do this. So like that Curly Fries example, you can run their whole set of algorithms on yourself. They have it online. And there's a few other ones in there. And when I try to do them, they don't work because there's not enough data. There's another one for Twitter called Tweet Delete, which is very easy to use. And you just put in a deadline. So like my I have like 15 Twitter accounts. My personal one, which I basically used to tweet about hockey games, like during the games, it keeps tweets for like 3 days and then it deletes them. You know, my dogs, I have 4 golden retrievers. They have a very popular Twitter account. I don't delete any of their tweets, right? Like, anybody can look at that for however long. And so we have different policies for different accounts, but getting rid of stuff is a great way to do that. Depends on who else you're worried about. I like to divide it up into, like, are you worried about, like, an ex-boyfriend, lawyers, like, say you're getting divorced and the lawyers want to find dirt on you, or the CIA. I can give you some advice if you're worried about the CIA, but that's a much harder group to protect yourself against. But for the other groups, you know, depending on which ones you're worried about, move towards using, like, more ephemeral communication. Snapchat is like the classic example of that, but you can, so I use Signal, for example. How many of you use Signal for private messaging? All right, you also use Signal for private messaging. It's an instant, like a texting program, but it's encrypted fully in each direction, which means that hackers or the NSA cannot spy on what you're saying. They also can't hack it, and you can set those messages to auto-delete. So, you know, my husband and I text on there, not that anyone would care about like what we're gonna have for dinner, but it's a great idea to shift to that. And if I were, say, a whistleblower who's sharing documents and stuff about my company with a journalist, we can do it on Signal. It's encrypted so it can't be intercepted, and I can set that to delete after 2 minutes if I want, after 2 days if I want. I think we all need to think about generally using more ephemeral communication more often, both in terms of social media and regular communication, because we saw in the last election with like the Hillary emails, the impact that having that hacked can have. It was like my worst nightmare to have my Gmail account hacked, right? But a lot of stuff we do in there doesn't need to be on email, right? It can be on like a secure text messaging thing that's gonna go away in a couple days. And we haven't had to think about that too much till now, but I think if we think about, like, is this something I'm really gonna need an archive of? You know, how sentimental do I really wanna be about my data? Like, sentimental enough that I'm okay with it being hacked and potentially exposed so I can keep a copy of it on the cloud somewhere, right? Or, you know, if it's like, what do you want me to get at the grocery store today? Like, I could keep that for a day and then have it delete. So I think a move towards more ephemeral in all senses is a great way to protect yourself. So delete stuff that's up there if you don't need it. Keep an archive for yourself personally and don't trust it to Facebook. And then just think about, in general, a shift towards more ephemeral communications is gonna be a pretty effective way to protect yourself.
Sure. What about cloud-based file storage?
I don't do a lot of it. So I have a Dropbox account and a Box account, like for big files or for like collaborative things. I would never, ever sync my phone photos to the cloud, ever. I would never, ever, ever do that. Because all it means is that you're gonna let everybody see all your photos, right? Like, it's going to get hacked. It's pretty easy to get hacked. Apple, you know, I love my iPhone. They have not been like the best in terms of the kinds of security that they should have over their cloud. They've been really slow to respond to like known weaknesses. So yeah, it's a pain to not have stuff synced to the cloud. Like, it becomes really comfortable, and a lot of devices are working, so like you actually have less storage because they assume you'll have cloud access. I would think really carefully and assume that it's going to get hacked if you're storing it in the cloud, basically. And you know, if somebody hacks like my student's dissertation, like, she's got a backup, I don't care, right? Or whatever paper I'm working on, like, it's not sensitive in the way that, you know, my photos on my phone are. So, yeah, I mean, I would assume you're gonna be hacked and then make your decision. Sure.
As someone who studies public health, though, I feel like the balance now is keeping this from being debilitating to people, because at the end of the day, I mean, I'm so careful, but my husband and I both just were victims of the skimmers at gas stations at the Kroger fuel plant.
Oh, yeah, I'm sorry.
So we're so careful, but, you know, we get gas, and we didn't know to check for the skimmer, and within 3 weeks of each other. So I do think, in knowing the good implications of some of this with public health,
I don't want to scare people off using this, right? Like, I use social media probably too much all the time, right? You know, like I said, I really think it comes down to a question of consent. And in some places you can assume it, right? So if you're monitoring Twitter, say for public health issues, people that are putting stuff out publicly, they have consented for that to be read, right? But I think there's a difference between, like, people are looking at what I'm sharing, and people are making copies of it, storing it, and using it to profit off me or to cause me harm, right? Like, prevent me from getting a job or a mortgage, which has absolutely happened with these dollars. Or insurance, yeah. I mean, the health insurance has always been my, like, classic example of, like, you know, do I want my insurance companies predicting my future risk for, say, heart disease? I run marathons. I'm super healthy. My dad had a heart attack at 51. I don't think I have those genes. I've had all the tests. But my insurance company would love to know, right?
Yeah.
So, yeah, I mean, I definitely don't think these are bad. I build these algorithms, right? Because I think there's all kinds of really positive, wonderful things that will come from them. But I am 100% behind the idea that people should be able to consent to having their data used in whatever way. And so, yeah, I mean, I think for public health things, if you're using public stuff that's out there, if you're, you know, keeping individuals anonymous or you're not reporting it in a way that would affect them, that's generally pretty fine. And if it creeps you out, right, so you're like, recommender systems, I don't know so much about that, like, have the right to opt out of it, right? So yeah, I don't think it's all bad, and, you know, I confess that this is creepy, partly because it's entertaining to do it in a creepy way. But yeah, I mean, I think there is a balance, and we don't really know what it is yet, but certainly not that it's all evil. We just have to figure it out. Yeah. Is that it? Timekeeper?
Courtney? maybe one more.
We'll take one more question.
How much salient should we put on the data never goes away? You can delete it, but it's always there. Some robot has stored it. Don't even bother.
So definitely ignore the don't bother. I get this pushback sometimes in response to this advice, like delete stuff from Facebook, delete stuff from Twitter. It's true that Facebook could have a copy of it that they keep. They say they're going to delete it eventually. I kind of believe them. I've been an expert witness in two lawsuits against Facebook. One was just a patent case, but one was a class action lawsuit that I think just settled about their monitoring of private messages, which they were doing. So when we do those class actions, I just come in and report facts about it. I was real glad about that class action one. I went in, I spent days at Facebook looking at their source code and hired another guy who spent 6 months full time looking at their source code. We can see what they're doing, right? Now, we're not allowed to release the insights from that, but I think the class action space is where, the legal space is where I think we're gonna see a lot of pseudo legislation come from, because it's gonna be a long time before legislators start to do something about this. But this class action was based on a wiretapping statute, and there's other statutes that do that. So if Facebook says they're deleting data in their terms of service, if we somehow find out that they're not, there's a clear lawsuit there that can happen, and a lot of people who are members of a class that would bring that class action. So it's pretty reasonable to believe that if they say they're going to delete it, then eventually they will. Now, are there copies of it elsewhere? People can certainly have stuff downloaded, but the Internet Archive is not archiving social media because it's blocked. Twitter is archived by the Library of Congress, so they just get a copy of every tweet, but they're very protective of that data set. You really have to go through a lot of hoops to be able to access it. I think it comes down to this question of ex-boyfriends, lawyers, or the CIA. If you're worried about the CIA, you're not going to delete anything, right? If you're worried about, lawyers or marketers or kind of people, just regular people, you definitely are better off deleting things. It becomes very, they don't have access to those secret archives that are stored places, and it's really hard for them to get that data. You can never be 100% protected in all cases, but if you delete old stuff, most of the applications that I've talked about will stop working because they need access to live data. So, yeah, it's not 100%, but it's a good 75, 80%.
What happens when, you have a tweet out there and you delete it? I know that somebody might have, screen captured it here or there, but how vulnerable is that? Just the one, if you haven't deleted all your data, but just the one.
Yeah.
You made a typo. In my case, it's a typo.
I always do those typo ones. Yeah. So there's certainly archiving programs that are grabbing tweets. Absolutely. This Library of Congress archive will likely have it because they just can't deal with all the deletions. If it
typo
makes,
is internal.
Yeah, yeah. If you make it into the the Twitter streams, right? So they have the garden hose, which is 1% of all tweets, and the fire hose, which is 10% of all tweets. Those are publicly accessible. We have a running archive of the garden hose at Maryland. So if your tweet makes it into the garden hose and we grab it and then you delete it, we still have it. So there's a 1% chance of that. You have 10% chance it gets into one of those two streams. Then there's nothing that you can do. And if you're a public official, if you're of interest, somebody is definitely screen capping all of those. They have bots that run and do that, which I, kind of back to how we started, is great for government transparency and whatever, because you can't get away with deleting stuff. It does make it a little hard with those stupid typos that they could be out there in perpetuity. I've spent a lot of time with the Twitter garden hose, the 1% stream. I think we have 3 or 4 years of it archived at Maryland, and we have an average of 1 to 2 tweets per person in there. So none of these algorithms would work on an individual from what you can get just from that stream, for what it's worth.
All right, well, let's thank our speakers.